Hi, I'm Ken Mingis. Welcome back to Mingis on Tech, where we talk about what's hot and what's not in technology. I've got Lucas and Keith here with me today, and we're talking about killer autonomous cars and the potential for killer robots. I think this is going to be the disaster tech edition. What prompts this is a killer robot. That's the Staples killer robot, right?
Yeah, this is the Staples folder.
I want a killer autonomous car.
Yeah, right. Well, you may get one day.
Is that like Christine from Stephen King?
Yes. In fact, it is without the haunting. Now it's intentionally artificial intelligence that kills you.
Killer car. Okay,
What prompted this was a study that I think MIT did that was published in Science and then picked up in a lot of places about a dilemma that's coming up. Now that cars have all kinds of features that allow autonomous driving, they'll keep in the lane, they'll stop if there's something in front of them, they'll, you know, adjust the car speed when you're doing cruise control, and autonomous cars apparently are something that a lot of drivers expect to be on the road within a few years. The question is, what happens when your autonomous car comes up on a crowd of people in the street, can't stop in time, and has to make a decision to either kill them or veer off the road and kill you, the driver? And so it presents this ethical dilemma that this study looked at, and I was just kind of fascinated because there's not really an answer for this yet. And if you're going to have autonomous driving cars on the road, these are the kinds of questions that people need to think about. So my question, you know, Lucas, I know you looked at some of the study and some of the details, and the question I have is, you know, is this going to be, or do you think this could be a real roadblock to getting autonomous cars on the highway?
Yeah, that was the interesting part of the respondents, the survey, you know, their responses is that on one hand, people like the idea of a car basically doing as little damage as possible. So they wanted their car not to hurt pedestrians, but at the same time did not want their car to then sacrifice their lives. So they were given, like, there were six different surveys. They were given a bunch of different scenarios. You know, what if there was an orphan, a homeless man, and a widow walking across across a crosswalk, and they had the green light, and your car was coming at them? Do you swerve and go into a telephone pole?
And die.
Or do you just run them over? And, of course, you know, you choose to run them over. I
mean, right, yeah.
No, seriously.
Is this to determine whether you're a sociopath or not?
There is that. That's sort of embedded. Yeah. But
people would choose, run me off the road, you know. But then they were also given this.
Different scenarios is where it gets more nuanced, which is what I found
so fascinating. Exactly, it gets more nuanced. And on top of that, then they were told, you know, should your car always protect you? And they chose that as well. So there was a duplicity here where people always wanted their car to be programmed to protect them above all, but yet didn't want them to, like, mow down lots of people. And then the other thing I found really interesting was that they don't like the idea of the government being able to make that decision. So they're saying, look, I don't want to buy an autonomous car that's governed by my government's regulations that will tell, you know, that will take over from me and kill me instead of the people outside my car.
Yeah,
Do they think that that's going to happen, that there would be legislation that says autonomous cars must kill the passenger in scenarios?
That's the question. Who would decide what the rules would be? Is it the programmer who makes the software for the AI that drives the car?
Yeah.
Is it the manufacturer of the vehicle itself? Is it the government that sets the rules and then, you know, you have to obey those rules? Or do you have, like, some sort of switch in the car where you can kind of decide, today I want to protect myself and everybody else be damned? Or, you know, where you – and then if you have that kind of switch and you make that decision and your car kills someone, who's liable?
Right.
You?
Right.
Or, well, you know.
The government does have laws designed to protect everybody in terms of driving. That's why you have, you know – you can't take a right on red in certain locations and all those other street rules, like don't go past the speed limit. So all of those rules you would think would be programmed into the computer or the AI that's running this.
Yeah.
But as a human being, sometimes I have to make that decision if I'm driving a car. You know, if something's swerving at me, I know that, like, if a car is coming straight on and is in my lane, I know that I cannot go into the other lane because then I'm at liable if I hit someone else.
Right.
So there's all those things that you learned when you're driving at, you know, age 16, 17.
Right.
But on the other hand, I don't want to get hit because I don't want to die.
Well, that's...
So there are some times when you look and you're like, okay, there is no traffic coming.
Yeah.
So I will swerve.
Veer to the left around and go.
I will swerve and avoid the car that's coming at me this way and then get back into my lane as quickly as possible. You know, we've seen some accidents that have happened with the autonomous cars, but they've all been fender benders.
Right.
I'm waiting to see what will happen if an autonomous car is hit like by a drunk driver, for example, do you still blame anything that the autonomous car did, or do you accept the fact that there are other drivers out there that are not robots and that are, you know, and that might be bad drivers? And is that acceptable? You know, that those are the kind of questions that not only do the ethical discussion people have, but lawyers are going to get involved all over this.
Of course.
The interesting thing
about... What would you do as a human? Would you protect yourself?
Okay, so it's not...
I think it depends.
Yeah, it depends. it's not black and white, because you plow into a group of pedestrians, I guarantee the injuries to the pedestrians is going to be a lot worse than you hitting a telephone pole, because you've got airbags, you've got a crumpled front end, you've got all this safety equipment in your car. So it's not as clear cut as kill me or kill them. The car will swerve, and that safety equipment's getting better and better. But what I find really interesting about this is that this is life imitating art, in that you have all those movies like I, Robot, that already went through
these
scenarios.
Good movie, by the way.
Great movie, yeah. Wow, talk about, you know, foresight.
Perfect. Yeah,
and they had the three laws, and the robots in that movie, one of the very first law was that you cannot hurt a human being. And you, nor through any inaction, allow that human being to be injured. And it's very similar. When our cars become basically mobile devices, robots that will make decisions for us, we're going to have to present a set of rules to them. I have no doubt that our politicians, that our government is going are going to come up with rules that govern how these cars drive. And factored into that will be how safe the cars are. I mean, if you plow into a group of pedestrians, you're not likely to be hurt. But you're likely to kill or mortally, you know, injure those pedestrians. Yeah. At the same time, if you go off the road over a cliff, you're absolutely likely to be killed.
You're gone.
So, yeah. So what's the scenario here? Are you going off a cliff? Are you going into a telephone pole? There's a lot of nuances.
Well, it's interesting. You know, you mentioned the iRobot analogy in that movie. Have you seen the movie, Keith?
No, but okay. I didn't hear it was as good as you guys think it was.
The movie was great. In the movie.
But compared to the books, I think.
In the movie,
there's
a car accident.
Yeah.
And Will Smith is in a car accident, and another car is in the... They both go in the water, and a robot has to dive down and figure out who to save first.
Okay.
Him or like a little girl in the other car.
Right.
The robot makes the spot decision that he's got a better chance of survival than the girl does, and so he gets saved, and the girl ends up dying. So it's the same sort of analogy. Now, this is, of course... I don't know, 20, 30, 40 years down the
road. Yeah, I think Batman had a similar dilemma in one of those movies. Like, which one? Do you save Robin or do you save
why
your girlfriend?
Why does always come back to Batman?
I'm sorry.
Seriously. I mean, why Batman?
Because he loves
Batman.
But
it's the same ethical dilemmas that everybody's...
But interesting, back
this
to
this... is a robot. Okay,
back
sorry.
To this study, though, in terms of, like, what people would do. A lot of... I think I saw something that said 1 in 6 drivers would like to have an autonomous car. There, people are very good on autonomous cars saving the most number of lives, unless they're the driver of the car.
That's it.
Or
right.
even if they're the driver of the car, if they've got their spouse, daughter, some family member in the car, then suddenly people become much less likely to want the car to kill them, even if it means more people will die.
Yeah.
You know? And what was interesting about the study was that there really was not an answer. That this is, you know, these are the kinds of dilemmas that are going
to
come up.
And the problem is that you are asking programmers to try to come
to make
up
moral
with
decisions
and code in these ethical
and
moral
how do you
decisions.
Code that?
I don't know how you code moral decisions. It's just something that you've learned as you're growing up as a human being. You have to make certain decisions and you weigh the pros and cons of everything.
Well,
I don't know if AI is even at that point yet.
I'm sure it's not.
No, it's not. But you know, it's getting there.
But it will get there. I do think it will get there.
When it achieves like the singularity, right? When
in which case, we're doomed anyway.
Yeah, and we don't get to make
paging
any decisions.
Paging Skynet.
But they'll protect us. That's a good thing.
Yeah, exactly. Our future overlords.
But, yeah, I think at some point the government is going to have to step in and be the objective entity here. We're going to be subjective. We're always going to be subjective when it comes to our life versus somebody else's life. And the government's going to have to make a decision based on logic, you know. What's going to kill the fewest number of people?
Who's going to? Well, and the thing is, if you take this decision away from the individual, and as you say, government, and you know, make it a communal thing,
right?
Then the objective would be save the most people you can,
yeah.
And in total, you're probably saving maybe tens of thousands of lives, mm-hmm. but there will be these incidents where one person in the car gets killed.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, individual, that's a good point, though, making it communal. I want to shift gears a little bit before we wrap up, talking about robots.
I wanted to ask something about autonomous cars that I wanted to bring up.
Okay.
And I think this was one of your stories that you wrote about, because you had a discussion about Gil Pratt, who's now in charge of like Toyota's research.
Yeah.
But he used to work for DARPA, and he was involved in the robotics challenge. And so he did a lot of self-autonomous car stuff. But one of the quotes that I thought was interesting was that he was thinking that the guardian angel aspect of the technology,
yeah,
where the car doesn't become completely autonomous, but rather just helps you out.
I think we're definitely going to get there first. Yeah, absolutely.
We're already getting there in a lot of cars.
Yeah.
But then there was a quote about that he said something like, "People won't enjoy being chauffeured around. Like there are still people that like to drive.
That's me.
And I think that's a huge generational difference.
Yeah.
Between
younger drivers want to be chauffeured.
Yeah. And because that's why
Uber generation.
Yeah. But on the other hand, I also like the idea of being able to not have to think about driving on my daily commute.
Yeah.
So actually, I wouldn't mind an autonomous car on my everyday commute here, because then I could do things like sleep or read or check up on email and become more productive or just more enjoyable.
You're missing that the journey is the drive.
Right, but
the journey is the drive. You're missing the journey.
No, when I'm on vacation and I'm driving somewhere and I want to see the sights, then yes, then I want to drive. So maybe there's a mixture, but we are in the U.S. especially such a car-driven culture. I don't know. I think it's going to be a couple of generations. You know, by the time I'm old and retired, then I'll be like, fine, just put me in one of these chauffeured robot cars and I'll get to my doctor's
appointment. And send me off to the old home.
Well, that's another thing that Ford is doing.
Grandpa,
is
you're going for a ride?
They're developing self-autonomous cars for the older generation that you don't want. You know, you don't want me driving at age 80.
I'm not sure I want you driving now.
No, I'm a great driver now.
Everybody thinks you're a great driver.
I'm an excellent driver.
I know. Okay, anyway. Yeah.
It's just like everybody thinks they're funny, you know?
Yeah.
Boy, I'm getting killed in this one today.
It's a tough crowd.
All right, why don't you just switch gears then? I just thought it was interesting about Batman, the generational. Yeah, is the Batmobile an autonomous car or a semi-autonomous car?
Semi-autonomous.
I would think it's
semi-autonomous. He's got a remote control that can actually, I think it's fully autonomous.
Well, it has the option. Okay, well, the option to sort of turn it on if you're on the highway and you're going through the middle of Wyoming and it's a straight stretch of road for 50 miles and you want to kick on the autonomy.
So Wayne Enterprises is building autonomous cars. Right. That's what Elon Musk, I think. I think maybe Elon Musk is Batman or is secretly Batman.
He wants to be Batman.
So we will move
from killer cars to killer robots, and Keith, you prompted this video that I'll link to, that shows this robot that's sort of programmed to randomly
harm a human being
with a little pinprick from a diabetic needle,
like a diabetic needle. They've got this robot; it has a little arm, and the needle's attached to the arm, and then you put your finger there, and then it has an algorithm that assigns a random decision.
Yeah.
Like, all right, I see the finger.
I'm
do
just
going to
tap the finger, or I'm going to
hit it pretend with the needle. To and then not do it.
Yeah.
And so the IDG News Service reporter that did this, Magdalena, did the interview with this guy who built it, asking them why he built it, because he wants to have a discussion about
the whole point.
The whole point of robots aren't supposed to harm people via these three laws, but what if you program something that could?
Right.
How would that make the human feel? How does that get involved in the whole discussion? And then she did a second video where she discussed, how she felt. And she said, well, I created this bond with this robot, even though I'm not supposed to. And then
she was sort of personally hurt.
Yeah.
It had hurt her.
Right.
Even though it's an algorithm acting out. But, she was used to the robot being nice and friendly, and then it stabbed her once, and she was hurt.
And then especially as you start seeing like these household robots that are all cute and they've got cute eyes and they look
like little dogs or
and
little
then all of a sudden you know
they go on the attack and take your leg off.
But isn't that true
of so many things? Hacker gets into the system and changes the code, I mean, what kind of thing, you know,
I mean,
how do you deal with that?
People name their cars already and treat them like
I don't name my car.
Don't look at me. That's
I did
actually
not
a bad
name,
thing
I've never
to do.
I don't name
it's
my car.
Because
it's a
then
car.
They turn on you
Christine.
Inevitably.
Yeah, exactly.
I've never named a car.
I don't name my cars.
I don't do that.
My cars are just my cars.
Yeah.
Anyway, so killer robots, mm-hmm. killer cars.
Yeah.
There is no answer.
We're all doomed.
We're basically doomed. Either the car will drive us off the road or the robot will kill us when we get home. But it seemed like an interesting topic. Good fodder for conversation as we go down this road to AI. We do need to be thinking about these things. And by the way, before I wrap it up, I want to mention that Linda went into an Apple store. Linda is my friend who has a 3G, an iPhone 3G, and I've been railing for years that she needs a new phone. She went into an Apple store last week ready to buy a new phone. the line was too long. So, Linda, you still need to get a new phone.
We were so close, Linda.
I know. It was close.
That's from, so like just during a normal midday
visit? It was an
Apple
store. It was clearly not a Microsoft store. If you've seen them side by side. If you've seen them side by side.
That's a fact.
You can't get into the Apple store and it's like tumbleweeds in the Microsoft store.
They have more
employees
mulling around in there.
Yes, they do.
Yeah, sadly.
Looking like shoppers, I think. Yeah. So anyway, that's the update on the phones. That's our story for this week. AI will get us one way or the other. Keith, thanks. Lucas, thanks. That's a wrap.